Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Dave Hanson and you are tuning into our NeuroStorm Workshop. This is one of the more popular workshops that we've done dozens and dozens of times over the years, both here in the office, out in the community, and online. So I wanted to get a new version up here for you guys so you have the latest of the science and research to make sure that you're getting the best information possible on how you can help your kids. So the point of this workshop and what we're going to be going over is this stuff. So the goal by the end of this is that whether you're here for ADHD, autism, sensory processing, oppositional defiant disorder, or any of the others that fall in this neurodevelopmental world, or if you don't have a diagnosis at all or just concerned about your kid, to understand where these challenges are coming from, how the nervous system fits in, and then what you as parents can do about it. Now, if you don't know me, I am Dr. Dave Hanson here at Hanson Family Chiropractic. I am a pediatric and family chiropractor. This is my family there. That's my wife, Kristen. We've been together since we were in high school. And those are our two little dudes, Jack and Jonathan, who are both awesome and hilarious and exhausting, as any parent I'm sure can agree with. But the reason why we do this workshop, and the reason why we've done it so many times, is because the word doctor actually means teacher. And so that's something we take very seriously in going out to educate our community and the people all over the world. And that's been, my wife was a teacher for a number of years before helping me start the office here. And so that's just kind of ingrained into who we are and what we do. And so this is one of the many workshops that we've done over the years. So this is the other Dr. Dave. Our office has two Dr. Daves. Dr. Daves make the best chiropractors, by the way. But he's actually a good friend of mine. We were in school together. He was my chiropractor for years. And then we decided in early 2018, what are we doing? Let's just merge our practices together. So we did that, and it's been really great. He's the nicest guy you'll ever meet, but he was a professional fighter, so you do have to be nice to him. His wife, Brooke, is an amazing occupational therapist here in St. Charles. So if you need somebody, she's one of our favorite referrals because she and her whole team is just fantastic. But our practice as a whole is a little bit different than maybe what you've experienced. Half of our patients are kids. We have a bunch of pregnant moms that we care for as well. And while we certainly do see the classic chiro stuff where people typically associate us with neck pain, back pain, and headaches, we see a whole bunch of other stuff too. When people, parents, are looking for just a safe, natural alternative to what they'd be getting through the medical healthcare system, and they want something a bit more natural and holistic to help them be healthier. So we see a lot of different stuff at our office, so don't be afraid to ask us about just about anything. Now, the reason why we focus on kids here is a pretty good story, and I'll try to keep it short, but when I first went to school, I had never planned on being a pediatric chiropractor. I was going to work with sporty people, CrossFitters, things like that. But then I went to this place and had quite an experience. So what we're looking at here, this is the island of Ometepe in Nicaragua. There's two volcanoes there. They're surrounded by shark-infested waters. There's little power, little running water. It was a very remote and isolated place. And the clinic that me and my friends were volunteering at was the only form of healthcare that the people on the island had, unless they took like an hour's long ferry ride to the mainland. So we saw a lot of different things with all the people there. In fact, my first patient was a guy who hacked off his toe with a machete. It's like, I don't know, man, I'm a chiropractor. But we figured it out because we had to. But my second patient was a little baby. And at the time, I had only taken one weekend seminar on how to work with kids. Since then, I've taken hundreds. But at the time, it was just one. But in the group I was with, that made me the expert because no one else had taken any. So when someone brought in their baby, they came to get me. And I said, sure, I'll take a look, thinking it was going to be colic or constipation or something, you know, simple. But when I went back in the room, it was a mom who was just crying her eyes out, holding this limp, twitching baby. He wasn't even crying. He was just spasming with every breath because he was just too weak to cry. He was all skin and bones. And I don't speak Spanish. Mom didn't speak English. But through a translator, I found out that it was a rough birth, whatever that meant, and that he wasn't nursing. He wasn't latching. And in a place like Nicaragua, if you're not breastfeeding, then you're not eating. And so the poor little guy was basically starving to death. So I panicked for a moment, and then I took the little guy and I checked him and first looked for reflexes, and he didn't have any, which is bad. And then my first thought as a chiropractor was, well, let's see what Atlas is doing. That's the top vertebra in your spine. And because I know that's the most vulnerable part of any baby during any birth, certainly a rough one, as mom described this. And sure enough, his atlas was subluxated out to the right. So I gave him a little adjustment. It's very different with babies and kids, but it's definitely babies if you've ever been adjusted yourself. I just used my pinky. It's just this very subtle little thing. But he started crying. It was like he came back online and gave him back to mom and nurse him. And he latched and he got his first meal in I don't know how long. And it was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen, chiropractic or otherwise. And it was also a very sobering moment because that little guy didn't need one adjustment. He needed a whole series of care, and he wasn't going to get it. I was leaving in a couple days. Mom had taken a three-hour bus ride and leaving her other kids with a neighbor to come see us that day. And so he wasn't going to get another adjustment. And the reality for a kid like this in a place like Nicaragua was that he might not make it, and that was a terrible thing. But when I thought about my own community here in Fox Valley, there's not a lot of failure to thrive, thank God, but there is a lot of ADHD and sensory and autism and colic and constipation and ear infections and allergies and all these things that these kids are struggling with. And what if we took the same adjustment that brought this kid back to life and applied it to the same kids in our neighborhood, would we see really powerful things as well? And so that's when this pediatric chiropractic thing stopped being, you know, just a niche and became the mission. But to make that story awesome, I told everyone that story when I came back to school. And a friend of mine, Lena, went a year later and she happened to bump into that little guy. So this is a picture of him a full year later. So obviously he's doing great. You know, you can see he's a super happy little guy. He still has some challenges, but whole different scenario than when I first met him a year prior. And we keep his picture sitting framed in on the wall, so we can look at that anytime we're talking to parents about their kids, so we can always remember the power and the potential of what happens when you get a kid reconnected again. So anyway, that's why we focus on kids here in our practice. But grown-ups are welcome too. So to start out, we're going to do kind of a fun thing. We're going to take a little test, or you guys are going to take a test. So just listen to the instructions, follow along, and let's see how you guys do.
This is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
The answer is 13.
Anybody get it?
But did you see the moonwalking bear?
Go!
There he is. So if you didn't see the bear, don't worry about it. So far, no one has in all the times that I put this on. And the reason why I do this is it's easy to miss something that you're not looking for. So the stuff that we're gonna talk about today in this workshop, none of it is real obscure information. This is all backed by research in medical journals, not even chiropractic journals. This is all very mainstream stuff. But just the dots haven't been connected in such a way that we're going to review tonight. So the most common phrase we hear in our office is, why has no one told me about this before? And unfortunately, that's just because chiropractic, or me as a chiropractor, I'm never going to have a Super Bowl commercial, right? Even medical doctors aren't able to do that, but the drug companies that supply them have gobs of money that they can do all kinds of wonderful advertising with. I'm an individual office. I can't do that. The way I get the word out and am able to share this information with parents is stuff like this. So if you found this information useful, please share it with friends and family, post on Facebook, whatever you gotta do, because this is how we reach more kids and are able to help more people. So let's get into it. So what is the NeuroStorm? So chiropractors like acronyms. So we call it the three T's, but it's just the amount of stress that these kids are exposed to earlier in life than you and I ever did, and to a greater degree than you and I ever were. But we call it the three T's. It's traumas, toxins, and thoughts. And traumas would be physical stressors. And that can be whether it's in utero constraint, the birth process itself, spills and falls that kids always do. Toxins would be if they have a cruddy diet. Some kids come in pretty heavily medicated. Sometimes there's environmental things like smoking that are a stressor. And then thoughts would be even moms during your pregnancy. If a kid's not sleeping great, if they're a little bit older in their school and there's some social concerns there as well. But all this has this cumulative effect and overloads these kids. But like I said, it starts before they're even born. Moms, thinking about your own pregnancy and how like seemingly at every step of the way there, they just scare the dickens out of you. If you've ever read What to Expect When You're Expecting, it's like a Stephen King novel. It's everything that could possibly go wrong, which in a lot of ways is a self-fulfilling prophecy, because moms, if your body is swimming in adrenaline and cortisol because you're stressed out, so is babies. You guys share a blood supply and a nerve supply, so that is absolutely affecting the little guy. And then you actually get to the birth process, and very little of that makes sense from your perspective as mom, even from the way they position you laying in bed. Laying on your back with your feet up in the stirrups, that's good for only one person, the doctor. It's really easy for them to do what they want to do and keep an eye on things when you're in that position. It's not comfortable for you. It compresses the sacrum and makes it harder for baby to get out. It makes no sense unless you're the doctor in that situation. So there's a lot of different things that happen there that make you a good patient, but not necessarily put you in a position to have a good birth, which is unfortunate not only for you as moms, but for the babies involved. But you end up with this stressed out, colicky, crying baby and are told that, don't worry, he'll just grow out of it. And sure, they grow out of that, but they turn into a sick kid. Maybe they start getting a bunch of ear infections or allergies, and or they're constipated and they can't handle new foods. Then they start getting to school and they start getting labeled. Maybe they're hyper. Maybe they have sensory processing challenges. And before you know it, you get all these different therapists appointments that you got to keep track of, and are trying to get them to indulge in new foods because they are not willing to try it. And you're like, where did this happen? And looking back, you can start to see how the snowball started to build and get bigger over time before you end up where you're at today and watching this video by me online. So what happens with all those stressors, why that matters, is there's a cumulative effect to all of that. So even though physical, chemical, mental stress are very different things, they all have to be experienced and processed by your nervous system. That's the umbrella system that controls everything we experience and do. And as these stressors start to increase, just like the engine on a car, you end up in the red zone, the needle's all the way in the red, and your body is just full-fledged stuck in this fight-or-flight survival mode because of this accumulation of stress over time. Now, what I mean by that is your nervous system, while that does control every single thing that your body says and does and perceives, it only has two settings. Yeah, your nervous system is either in sympathetic fight or flight mode, or it's in parasympathetic rest and digest mode. That's it. The sympathetic gas pedal side, that's not bad. It's just meant for the right situation. Like if you're scared, playing sports, things like that. Things where you need to worry about survival, right? The parasympathetic brake pedal side, that's growth and development. That's immune system, digestive system, sleep. All the healthy stuff happens over there. Now, we should be in balance. You know, neither one, you don't want to be dominant to either side. You want to be nice and balanced. Your body can do whatever it needs to do at that particular time. But the biggest thing is how that changes your perception of the world. And what I mean by that is, if you imagine that your body is under tons of stress, that you're just in this sympathetic fight or flight mode, like a bear is about to attack you, right? You see the world differently. And if you imagine like a classroom, let's say it's got 20 kids in it, and 19 of them are sitting there calmly listening to the teacher and absorbing the information, and you got the one squirrely kid who just can't sit still, think about them instead of being bad behaviors, and think about them as being in this sympathetic fight or flight state, right? Because stress in a kid looks different than stress in an adult. Stress in a kid looks squirrely, right? If their neurology, if their brains are telling them that they need to be concerned about survival, they get fidgety. Their muscles are on, amped up, ready to go so they can fight or flight. They stop turning on the immune system and digestive system, so they get backed up and they get sick. All these things because the way that their bodies, subconscious, are seeing the world is different. And that's what we have to work with if we want to make a lasting change. And I love this visual here, with to illustrate that point about perception, if you look at the little quadrant here, you got the two squares that are labeled A and B. A looks darker than B, right? Pretty simple. But what if I told you they're exactly the same color? So what just happened there, right? They look so different, and then all of a sudden you tell me that they're the same. Your eyes are absolutely seeing that they are exactly the same color. Your eyes aren't lying. But what happens is your eyes take that information and send it back to your brain to process that. And your brain looks at the whole picture and it sees a shadow going across B and thinks, well, they can't possibly be the same color because you got a shadow going over it. And I can see that in a line that these should be different colors. So it changes the way you're seeing there. So, I mean, that's amazing if you think about it. Your brain just changed what you saw, and it did it without your permission and without you knowing about it. This is a big deal. This is a simple, like, optical, like, test. But, again, think about that in broader terms, like with these kids that are stuck in this sympathetic fight-or-flight place. If their bodies are in this place where they're feeling that survival is something it needs to focus on, it changes what the way they're seeing their world. And so their behaviors, where it may see amped up, fidgety, or hyper to you and me, to them it feels perfectly appropriate to their situation. They're trying to take in all the details because that will help with survival. They're trying to get their muscles amped up because that will help them with survival. They are not going to be focused on learning and growth because that is not helpful right now if they're in a survival situation. So if we can get their nervous system to start perceiving the world as it is, some really powerful things can happen with these kids, and we see it all the time. So, why is a chiropractor talking about this? We're back doctors, right? We're supposed to deal with spine and necks. Well, that is very relevant because your spine and your neck isn't just structural. Sure, it's helping keeping me vertical so I can talk to you guys right now, but it goes way beyond that. Your spine is how your brain and your body communicate with each other. Uh-oh. Skipped ahead. Your spine is how your brain and body communicate with each other. So you're, like I said before, your nervous system, your brain, is what is in charge of every single thing your body does. But your brain's all locked away in this quiet, dark skull. It can't do anything unless it sends messages down through your spine to the different parts of your body telling you what to do. And your body has sensors all over it to gather information from the environment, both external and internal. And it takes that information and sends it back up through your spine into your brain. So your brain has an accurate idea of what's happening in its world. And all that communication is happening through your spine. So when I think spine, I'm not thinking just about the structure. I'm thinking about the function of your spine, which is to enable your brain and your body to talk to each other. And if you think about it, is there anything more important than that for your overall health? I can't think of anything. So let's talk about that. So this is the nerdiest part of the workshop, okay? We're gonna get in some you know, more complicated words and phraseology. Don't feel the need to write it down and Google it unless you're an analytical person like myself, then go nuts. But we're gonna talk about this thing called subluxation. So when a chiropractor adjusts you, the subluxations are what they're adjusting. Most people have never heard that word unless they've been to a chiropractor, but you can think about it like a dislocation, but more subtle. Your spine doesn't dislocate. If it did, then like that would be it for you. Your spine subluxates. The same idea, but a lot more subtle. If given enough time, it's probably going to hurt like a dislocation does, but that takes time. But that's why so many grown-ups do have neck and back pain issues. But we're dealing with is subluxations, which has four components. The first of which is dyskinesia. So dys meaning dysfunction, kinesia meaning movement. So poor movement. So just think of it like a bent hinge on a door. If you bend that hinge, the door's not going to swing properly. You have a motion problem. Where does it start with kids and even babies? Again, back to birth. Back in the day, when our office was small, and I was the guy who was answering the phone, if a mom called in and said, I'd like to get my kid checked because they have ADHD, let's say for example, my first question would be, well, tell me about the birth. Was it a C-section? And the reason I would ask that question is because it's so stinking common in these kids that have these bigger challenges that whether it's a C-section or some other sort of birth intervention, some sort of big stress was brought in there on that first day. Now, even if you've had a C-section, Moms, you didn't know what was going on. You're drugged up and you got a curtain hanging in front of you. Dads didn't know what's going on because they don't want to peek behind that curtain, and who could blame them? So most people who have been through that that procedure don't really even know what happened. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show a short video of what a C-section actually looks like so you get an idea of what I'm talking about. I don't like watching that video. I don't like showing it to others, but there's nothing I could say that could illustrate that point better. So what just happened there, that was 60 to 90 pounds of traction that was put on that baby's head and neck. 60 to 90 pounds. I've had moms tell me that they feel their hips come up off the table during a C-section, and what I tell them is, well, do you realize that they just picked you up by your baby's head? And what's happening there is, during a vaginal birth, your moms, you're pushing this way, baby's wiggling down this way, everybody's going that same direction. In a C-section, your abdomen acts as a vacuum. So the doctor has to grab head and neck and twist and pull with a lot of force to get that little guy out of there. And if that's what has to happen to get baby out of mom safely, thank God we live in a time and a place where that's a relatively routine thing to do. I just wish that there was somebody like me in the next room to help baby deal with what just happened there. Because that's always a big deal. And that's not something that I just noticed anecdotally here in our office. This has been well researched for decades. And I mean medical research in like OB journals. Yet somehow it's not mainstream. The first large scale study that I'm aware of was done by Dr. Gutman, again, a medical researcher, who he looked at over 1,000 babies from all different type of births. And he looked at them right after they were born. And he found that 80% of them were subluxated right up here, significantly enough to be impacting the function of their nervous system and their immune system. And the only logical conclusion anyone could reach after that is that all babies should be checked by a chiropractor after born, regardless of their symptoms or the birth experience itself, because that's such a high number, everyone should really be checked. And this study has been repeated like many times over the years. The most recent one I saw was a few years ago, 2-3 years ago, and that doctor, again a medical doctor, concluded that 99% of babies were subluxated and need to be checked by a chiropractor. So again, this is medical research and medical journals brought to you by a chiropractor. So why is your OB not know this and share this with you? Why are you finding out about it after the fact? I don't know. I don't know what to tell you about that. I do know that OBs, obviously, they never see the kid again. So that connection is obviously harder to establish, that situation led to some of these challenges later in life. For us, it's like a flashing neon sign that this is a big deal, needs to be addressed. Unfortunately, we are usually delivering this information years after the birth, when that kid had that injury that no one noticed for years. So, oh, and this is another study that was a couple years ago, and what they did was they looked at autistic kids and looked through their history to see if they could find commonalities. Like, what's the common thread that is woven through these kids? And where that big arrow was pointing there, you're almost 40 times as likely to end up with an autism diagnosis if you have an injury to your cerebellum at birth. Cerebellum's right here. So again, here we are talking about the top part of your neck being so not only so important, but so vulnerable during the birth experience, and how super relevant that is to all of these neurodevelopmental challenges. All right, so you got a baby gets a kink in his neck, right? You got this birth trauma. You can see how that would create a pretty physical distortion in their spine. Why does that matter, right? Well, that leads to dyskinesia, leads to disafferentation. Dys meaning dysfunction, afferentation referring to the input, the sensory input coming into their nervous system. And what happens is, if you have this distortion in your spine, it alters that communication process. And there's a really good video, actually was done for occupational therapists, but they do a beautiful job of illustrating this point. So I want to share that with you guys as well.
Some kids are really bouncy and can't sit still. Some kids aren't very coordinated. Some see food as a pile of toxic goo that hurts their mouth and jangles their taste buds. School might be a mysterious place where things don't make much sense. If this sounds like you, you may have sensory processing disorder, and we're going to explain it here. Your body has seven senses: vision in your eyes, hearing in your ears, touch in your skin, taste in your mouth, and smell in your nose. And you have two movement senses: your muscles and your sense of balance. In sensory processing disorder, these senses don't communicate right with your brain. Think of the nerves connecting your brain and senses as a set of roads. Those roads should be smooth superhighways so that the senses and brain can communicate fast. If you have sensory processing disorder, then some of your roads are bumpy and rough.
So I like that video because we work with OTs quite a bit, and the way we always describe it to patients, both us and them, is that we, as chiropractors, removing the obstacles to that communication, and then the OTs take over and groove those good neural pathways. And so you put chiropractic and OT together, you see some really wonderful results as a result of that. So proprioception, that's that sense they're talking about, that sense of movement. Why that's so important is your brain. When most people think about the brain, they think about the stuff that it's doing, right? It's telling my muscles to move, it's telling my stomach to digest food, all that stuff, which is great. But your brain is actually receiving 40 times more information than it's sending out. It's like a great big satellite dish. And the biggest thing that it's dealing with at any given point is proprioception. Proprioception, again, that sense of movement. It comes from all your joints. When police have people do this, that's what they're testing. Does your brain and your body know where each other are? Because alcohol inhibits that. But a lot of things do. Most of that proprioception, you get it from all your joints, every single joint in your body, but most of it comes from your spine, most of it from the top part of your neck. So again, here we are talking about this part of your spine for being so important to the health of your brain and your nervous system. Now, yeah, and again, what if this was your birth experience? Unfortunately, this is not like a joke picture. This is something that I saw in a medical book. He's bracing his feet there, it's terrible. But this happens to some kids. So that subluxation, I think of it as a sensory processing problem. There's like 10,000 different diagnosis codes in this neurodevelopmental world. I think most of them are nonsense, and sensory processing is the most accurate way of describing what's happening with these kids. Because again, their perception is off. That distortion in their spine is literally changing the sensory input coming in, and their brains are just responding to the information that it's getting. If we can change the input, we can change the output. So dysautonomia. This refers to dys being dysfunction, autonomia referring to your autonomic nervous system, which is essentially everything but the muscles, right? So your organs, your glands, all your internal stuff, growth, development, learning, speech, all that. That's your part of your autonomic system. And that's what I was referring to before when I said you only got two settings, gas versus brake, sympathetic versus parasympathetic. This is referring to your autonomic nervous system. You should be spending most of your time in parasympathetic. About 80% of the time you should be in that parasympathetic rest and repair state. About 20% of the time you should be more revved up. The kids that we see in our office, the kids that have chronic issues, and grown-ups that have chronic issues for that matter, are sympathetic dominant. Their bodies are stuck in this fight or flight place. And as a result of that, of course these things start to fail, and of course they start to have these challenges. It's not a coincidence that these kids that struggle in school are also can't poop and also get sick all the time and also run on an inhaler and have asthma and 18 other seemingly disconnected challenges when really they're all connected. It's because their nervous systems are just deprioritized, put on the back burner, their immune system, that digestive system, their ability to sleep and learn and grow because they feel like they're stuck in this sense of survival. So I have a favorite nerve. All the cool kids have a favorite nerve. Don't let anyone tell you different. But vagus nerve, and that's V-A-G-U-S, not like Viva Las Vegas, but if you were to Google anything after this, it's vagus nerve. Go vagus nerve and fill in the blank, whether it's ADHD, autism, whatever. You'll see tons of articles because this is a super important topic. Vagus nerve is Latin for the wanderer because it's the longest nerve in your body. Starts up here on your brainstem, comes down your spine on either side, hits your heart, hits your lungs, goes through your diaphragm, does all of your digestion. So it's huge, and it controls a ton of different things, different parts of your body. Super important. But Your vagus is also responsible for like your entire braking system. Anytime your body needs to do all this stuff, to slow down, to rest, to sleep, to turn on the immune system, to learn, to make friends, to deflame itself. Vagus nerve is responsible for most of that. So this one stinking nerve is like ridiculously important. And guess what? It passes within a millimeter of this top vertebra in your spine. So again, here we are talking about your atlas vertebra being so super important. Think about that little baby that I adjusted in Nicaragua and what his vagus nerve must have been doing at that time. But what we're looking at with this little graphic here, the green thing is atlas. Again, that's the top vertebra. You're looking at it from like a bottom up view. So the white stuff around there, that's the bottom of your skull. The little yellow dot in the corner there, that's vagus nerve. So what happens if you're pulled out of mom with a ton of force? You just lost your brakes. And if you lack brakes, by default, you're stuck on the gas. These kids, my favorite way to describe them, it's like they have these Ferrari engines of brains that are going 100 miles an hour, but bicycle brakes. And asking that kid to sit still in school and just soak up the information and feel totally comfortable with that is just not reasonable. If you or I had a dormant vagus nerve, we would have a really hard time doing that too. That's why grown-ups with anxiety and depression and things like that need to give their vagus some attention. But this, can you see why this is all of a sudden super relevant? 20 minutes ago, or however long I've been talking, you may not have understood why chiropractic makes sense for these kids, but now it could not make more sense for these kids. And why we see such incredible results in our office is because we're finally getting to the cause, right? If this was a physical challenge that started this cascade, it's gotta be a physical correction that's gonna get out in front of that. There's no drug or nutrition or supplement that's gonna help deal with that. That has to be adjusted by a chiropractor. So, dysautonomia, this dysfunction in your nervous system, that propensity of being stuck on the gas leads to the fourth and final D, dyspinesis. This is the output. I keep it simple. Good in, good out, garbage in, garbage out. If your brain is getting fed just nothing but noxious, stressful stimuli, of course the output of what the brain's gonna tell the body is to do is gonna respond in kind. The output simply matches the input. There's a really cool study, I don't know if you guys can read it, but parasympathetic functions in children with sensory processing disorder. This is another really new one that was put out here recently, and it was a cool study. What they did is they took a group of kids with sensory processing and a group of neurotypical kids and put them all together and measured their vagus nerve activity. We can do that. We do it every day here in our office. And then what they did, they just got a baseline, and the kids with sensory processing had a lower vagal nerve activity than the control group, which is expected, right? And then what they did was they challenged them. I think they like played a trumpet or they made some sort of loud noise to startle all the kids. Sounds kind of mean, but what happened was both groups, the kids with sensory processing and the neurotypical kids, both of them went to that sympathetic fight or flight mode because that's what's supposed to happen. But with the neurotypical kids, they came back down to their baseline really quickly, and the kids with sensory processing took a really long time for their bodies to calm down. So you may feel like if you've got a child with this sort of challenge that you're walking on eggshells around them, like it doesn't take much for them to all of a sudden just flip out and start throwing a tantrum or just being anxious or stressed, or you know, they go from 0 to 100 super quickly. It's because they are living on the edge. They're literally where they are. Their bodies just don't have the capacity or the resilience to deal with stress. So one little thing is often all it needs to do to tip the scales. So building those kids' resiliency to stress is a big part of what we do here. So what does chiropractic do for these guys? Well, if you've been to a chiropractor before, it's easy to understand how getting adjusted is going to help with the motion part of it, right? You have better range of motion in your spine if you're getting adjusted. But what most people don't realize is it doesn't stop there. If you have better motion in your spine, that means you have better sensory input coming up into your brain. That's a healthier brain. If your brain is getting fed this healthy movement, then you're not going to be stuck on this gas pedal fight or flight mode as much. If your body is not just stressed out dominant, your outward behaviors and feelings and actions towards the world are not going to reflect that stress either. So chiropractic is extremely powerful if doled out appropriately. So how do you know? How do you know if this is you or your kids? Well, you test. There's no guessing in our office. We have this really powerful scanning equipment that does this computerized neuro test to see exactly how the nervous systems are functioning. It's completely painless. It doesn't put anything into or take anything out of your kids. It measures heat, energy, and looks at the heart rate to look for variations in their heart rhythms. But we can take that and really learn a ton of information about how kids are actually functioning. And we're learning a great deal, and it's really rewarding to be able to do that. So, I'm gonna move me. I'm blocking it. There we go. All right. So, there's like I said, there's three different scans that we do in our office. We're only gonna go over one because I want to show you some examples. So we're only gonna do one just for the sake of simplicity. And I said earlier that I'm not big on labels, but there are three types of kids that we see, and I like my version. Because it's not only reflective of what you see outwardly, but also what's happening on the inside with the kids. So these are the EMG scans that we do. EMG stands for electromyography. It's literally measuring how much energy input is coming up through the nervous system. So the first type of kid that we see is called the raging bull kid. And they are just like it sounds. They are full of energy. They are bouncing off the walls all the time, can't slow down, probably have a really hard time sleeping, probably can't sit still in school. A lot of times they have anxiety, they're just real rigid in their muscles. They are likely have a diagnosis like ADHD or anxiety, something like that. When we scan them, this is what we're looking for. This would be considered normal or healthy. What we're looking at is, like I said, this is measuring energy. So white bars would be a normal amount of energy. Yellow would be too little. Green would be too much. Blue is way too much. Red is even more. Black is off the charts, way too much energy. So this is what we want to see here. All white bars, but you can see how it's also in like this pear-shaped type distribution. That's because you should have more energy going through your core than like through your neck, for example. And a raging bull type kid, they'll look something like this, where there is just noise. They're just getting just blasted with this stimuli. And this young man actually happened to be on Ritalin, so he was sitting there, you know, calm as a cucumber, but this is the storm that was happening inside. And what I told him is, or told his mom, is that it's like he's sitting front row seat at a Metallica concert, and then we're asking him to do his math homework. I'm like, that's not gonna work. I wouldn't be able to do my math homework if I had this type of, again, storm just brewing inside. I'd be squirrely too. The next type of kid is the drunken bull kid. These are the space cadets, the daydreamers. This is where there's maybe not too much stimuli in their spines, but it's just in this really bizarre, confusing pattern, and it just takes an extra second to kind of figure things out. These are the more like sensory processing kids. A lot of times there's balance issues. They're just clumsy. They usually have super slouchy posture because they have no core activation whatsoever. When we do their scan, again, this is what we're going for. What they look like is a little something like this. What you can see is not like a ton of excess stress, but it's in this really goofy pattern, and those yellows right in through the middle, that's the inactive core. And that's why you can remind them all the time to sit up straight. They can't, not because their cores are weak, but because their cores are inactive. And we need to wake that area up before they're even capable of turning those muscles on to support their spines properly. So the last type of kid is the combo kid. They're the drunken raging bull. This is where they have way too much stimuli in their system, and it's in this really bizarre pattern. These guys come with the bigger diagnoses. This is like the autism kids, seizures, things like that. When we do a scan on them, again, this is what we're looking for. They'll look a little something like this. Where again, it's just way too much energy, and it's in this really goofy pattern, and they're just overloaded all the time, and it's no wonder that their bodies just shut down. Autism actually used to be called Lockton syndrome, which I think is a very appropriate thing to call it, because it's just hard to reach these kids when their brains are this frazzled and this fried. It's hard to even communicate with them. So once we get this calm and get that the sensory input in healthier, a lot of really cool things happen. All right, so I want to give you a specific story. Ooh, I got to move me again. I'm in the way all over the place. There we go. Okay, so this is Ben. He came to us when I think he was 5 years old. He was adopted, so we don't know a ton about his birth story. We do know that there was some bruising on his face, so we can assume pretty safely that there was some sort of birth augmentation. I'm going to guess forceps just based on how he looked. But he had a ton of challenges. Sensory, his ADHD was his official diagnosis, but he had to be in a separate classroom with seven kids and five teachers. That's how hard these guys were to manage. And Ben's very blessed in that he was adopted by a family that had means. And so they tried everything. They didn't do drugs, they didn't want to do that, but he was in a bunch of different therapies. He was tons of nutritional stuff, tons of supplementation, a lot of things at home, like swings and stuff to try to help manage his energies. And it just really had minimal impact. And so when we saw him, when we scanned him, this is what it looked like. And you can see he's off the charts almost everywhere, where there's just way too much energy locked into this kid. And of course he was having the challenges that he was as a result of that. But once we took him through care, this is what it looked like. Way better, right? You can just see how much calmer this is. And a healthy amount of energy going through there means a healthier kid. And what he looked like outwardly was the coolest thing. So not only did they officially dropped the ADHD diagnosis, he's done with that. He's still not on medications, and he's in a normal classroom. He's in a normal everyday classroom and has tons of friends and all those things. But the coolest thing was what his mom told us, is that, yeah, you know, the school stuff is cool, the scan is improving, that's cool. But what's really cool is they can just enjoy their life as a family together. They can go on trips, because before they didn't want to leave the house because they didn't know what Ben was going to do. So now that he's calm and happy, they can just enjoy their family time together, which, how cool is that? So that was Ben. So to sum up, if you have a lot of stress, especially if it's early and especially if it's often, it literally changes the way your brains are wired. Your brain loves shortcuts, and if it gets exposed to a lot of stress early enough and often enough, it changes the way your brain, it forms its synapses, so it gets really, really good at getting stressed out, which by default means it's really, really hard for it to relax and rest. So your job as parents is to decrease the amount of stressors that the kids are exposed to. And that's what I'm talking about, food, I'm talking about adequate sleep, activities, good, you know, mental outlook, all those things are super important. Our job as chiropractors is to improve their ability to adapt to these stressors. Give them a greater capacity, greater resiliency when they're dealing with stress. That way their bodies don't tailspin and they can stop focusing on their perceived stressors and start focusing on growth and development and learning and making friends and all the healthy things that we need them to. So if you're watching this at home, I hope this was helpful. Please reach out to us if you have any questions or comments. If you are nowhere near us, please still reach out to us. We'll find a chiropractor near you. I've referred people to chiropractors as far away as Australia. So we'd love to hear from you. If you are in our area, please reach out to us to see about getting you and your family checked to see what we can do for you. There's no guessing, like I said, and when we do our exam, it's really clear what's going on with a person and what needs to be done to put them in a healthier place. So I hope you enjoyed this. This is a short video I want to close with. I actually put this together for my staff. It's easy to get bogged down in the day-to-day, and this was just a reminder for what it is we're really trying to do here, but I thought you would enjoy it as well. So thank you for watching.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. I can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. I can hold you in my for you with my all two hands, but you got to use your own two hands, use your own, use your own.